Hi. So today we're going to be talking about the CKE exam. This is going to be the fourth series. My name is Baotunde Oluisa. Most people know me as Tunde also. By the way, I am the real Tunde. And I'm a DevOps engineer / software developer also. I'm also certified as a Kubernetes administrator and a certified Kubernetes application developer. I co-organize this meetup with the other Tunde, and I really love cloud native tools. Today, for those who are just joining us for the first time or joining this series, in the past, we've talked about, the environments to use for practicing, like Minikube or running on AWS, using kubeadmin or running on bare-metal. We talked about, the requirements for this exam and what it takes to actually take this exam, some tips, some command line tips. We talked about how many questions we have in the exam. Basically, let me go over some of the things briefly. And the exam costs $300. There are 24 questions. It's a Linux-based exam. It's Ubuntu operating system. It takes 3 hours. You have 3 hours to complete this exam, and it's all hands-on. A lot of things within the exam environment have to do with administration. The CKE is really administration-based. It has to do with, creating pods, deployment services, knowing how to troubleshoot the cluster and working with volumes and etc. So you probably need to look at the curriculum. And also I have a link in the slide also that you can use to check out some of those information. So today in this series, before I start, did anyone recently get certified as a Kubernetes administrator, or anyone recently registered, or has there been anyone that has taken the exam that just maybe failed it the first time and would just like to say a little bit about it? Or is anyone open to just telling us why they're here today? Just, share with us what you like to learn from this CKE series. Because one thing is, we're trying to round up this series, and in the next couple of series, we're trying to go through Kubernetes, setting up Kubernetes the hard way using Kelsey Hightower's setup. And so, just in case if you've looked at the previous series and we've missed some things, or there's something you would like to share, please feel free to unmute yourself and just, share with us maybe something you would like to see maybe in the next meetup, or you'd like for someone to help you with. You can do that on the Slack channel. There's a lot of people in this community besides I and Tunde that are very, very good with Kubernetes. They're experts here with Kubernetes. The CKE exam is not about you being an expert. It's about you knowing how to take the exam. Now, you could have been working with Kubernetes for the longest time and still not pass the exam on the first time. And this is because you might face challenges with how you're answering questions during the exam. Just to remind you, there are 24 questions in this exam and they're all hands-on. And you have 3 hours to take this exam. Now, a lot of these have to do with, so one thing that's really important for this exam is familiarity with the exam environment, like the terminal, the OS. I like to tell people that understanding of, Linux command line is very, very important also. Knowing how to manipulate outputs with the kubectl or kubectl, like most people know it, to manipulate Kubernetes API, like to maybe create pods or maybe create deployment services, those would really help you during the exam. So without you know, I'm just going to give opportunity for anyone who would like, who has anything they would like to share, or just talk briefly about how they've been using Kubernetes and, you know, why they're just trying to get the, get certified as a Kubernetes administrator.
Okay, I have a quick question.
Two, three people.
How you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
All right, hey, thanks for the class, man. I appreciate it. This is the second time I'm looking at it. I have a quick question about the test. It's like, do they ask you to spin up a cluster, or is every, all the clusters are already there? You just need to do like services, pods, et cetera, troubleshoot it, that kind of thing. Or is there like, are you expected to run kubeadmin, I guess, and do a cluster? What is it?
Yeah, thank you so much for that question. And so the exam environment, the clusters have been created for you. So we have like multiple contexts. So context is how like the environments are being differentiated in Kubernetes.
Right. And no, I would say context.
Right, right. So we have several contexts within the Kubernetes, within the exam environment. And within this context, all everything the Kubernetes API and everything is running fine. So you don't have to worry about, you know, setting up or bootstrapping the cluster. Now, some of the things you need to look forward to for the exam is, and this is why we plan on doing a demo on Kelsey Items Kubernetes the hard way, is, you know, there might be a broken cluster, right? That you might have to maybe fix, do a set up TLS, or maybe make some changes to. And so you knowing how to set up Kubernetes, you know, by the Kelsey Items, using the Kelsey Items Kubernetes the hard way method is going to come in handy for those kind of questions. But for the most part of the exam, it's essentially cluster administration, creating port, deployment, based off exactly what you see in the curriculum. Like, you know, creating services, understanding that is big, persistent volumes, non-persistent volumes, dealing with data, talking about config maps, secrets and the likes of them. Just, you know, all these things are the same things we see in the curriculum.
Okay, so when you do like volumes and stuff, like, are you expected to do NFS volumes, create it yourself, or do they provide you with the NFS path? Or, I mean, is it, you know what I mean? Like, do they say, okay, go create an NFS, do NFS share and mount it, or what?
Yeah, from, again, from my experience taking the exam, you don't need to actually do any kind of creation of an NFS volume, or maybe creating keys for some of the things you need to do. All that is already provisioned for you. So a lot of what you need to do, trust me, this exam is a really good, easy exam if you have the right guidance. Like, in terms of, you know, if you're familiar with environment, if you're familiar with, you know, the things that you need to understand. Like, I always say to Tunde, like, whenever we're discussing, you know, what does it take to pass the CKA? One thing is, the biggest thing is constant practice and understanding and familiarity with the Kubernetes environment. Knowing how to create pods, knowing how to create deployment services, and knowing how to work with the volumes is really, really important. Like, and knowing where to find this like manifest for creating this these resources on the Kubernetes.io documentation page would come in handy for you also, because, you know, for an exam that is 3 hours long, you don't want to just wait until that day to start searching for a manifest that you most likely want to use, because that is going to eat out of your time. And also because there is a limitation to copy and paste during the exam, you probably want to get yourself familiar with, you know, with this, what this manifest would look like. Also, if you already have a manifest that you already copied the first time, you can make a copy of that manifest within your command line and just edit it to actually meet the demands of the question that you're working on.
Wait, so you can copy, you can have your own manifest already made and use it on the test?
No. I'm saying that you can during the exam, you can copy a manifest from the Kubernetes.io page. Okay. And use it during the exam.
Not from your computer or anything.
No, not from your computer.
Okay, and this is you take it, that would make it too easy, right? So this is you take it at home and you take it in front of your computer with the camera on like this, and then there's a proctor watching it, is that correct?
Correct.
And it's $300, and what's the passing grade?
So right now, the current passing grade, I believe, is 74%. So you have to get above 74% above to pass the exam.
Okay. And if you fail it, you can take it again under that whole, the same $300, right? You don't have to pay.
So you have one free retrial.
Okay.
After the first time, if you fail it. So like I said, give this a shot. You fail it the first time, you're already familiar. Once beaten, twice shy. You fail it the first time, you're more familiar with the environment and you can pass it the second time. Right. And let's say you fail it, unfortunately you fail it the second time, you can go ahead and practice and register for the exam and take it again.
Okay, so how long do you have to wait before you take the second try if you fail the first time?
Right now there are no restrictions. There are no restrictions on that.
Okay, cool. All right, yeah, it's really helpful. You know, I mean, any kind of information. I mean, I don't expect you to, you know, give me the, you know, the answers or whatever, but any kind of hint you can tell me on what I should do or how I should prepare, you know, that kind of stuff. If you need to go to the restroom or stuff, what do you do within that 3 hours? Do you tell them like, hey, I'm taking a bio break? How does that work?
Well, for the exam, now, I wouldn't advise going to the restroom, but you can go ahead and do that. But the problem with that is that your time is still going to keep on running. Right. There are no foods allowed during the exam. You're not allowed to talk. You're not allowed to cover your mouth. You're not allowed to maybe do this during the exam. Your exam terminal will be closed.
So, really? You can't talk? You can't even talk to yourself or anything?
No, you can't do that.
Oh, no way.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
You're not allowed to do any of that.
What if you start mumbling to yourself? You fail?
I mean, you're just going to have the person watching you, the proctor, tell you that you cannot do that. So you'll probably freeze your terminal and...
Really?
And they'll give you two warnings and that's it.
Right.
Oh, really? They give you
two warnings? You get two strikes.
Right.
Wow.
Thank you.
You're kidding.
Nope. They tell you it once, and if you do it again, you're done. They close the exam.
Okay, well, that's good to know.
So
kind of tough.
I'm going to try to take one more question. Any other person? One more question before I go ahead with this demo. There's going to be plenty of opportunities for questions at the end of the demo. And also, feel free to cut me off, like during the demo, if you want me to just touch back on something or, you know, kind of explain a little bit more about any other thing within the context of what I'm working on, please feel free to do that. So any other question?
Yeah, do we know what the success rate is for passing?
Oh, right now, I honestly can't give you any statistics on that right now. I might have to check back and post that on the Slack channel for you. But one thing I know is recently I've been seeing a lot of people actually pass the exam. And, you know, from the people that I've spoken to that have passed the exam, it's the one thing that I've noticed within all these people is it's not about the years of experience. It's not about, you know, how much of how much you've spent, you know, working with Kubernetes. It's all about your constant practice and you being, the way you've actually walked your way to being ready for this exam. Like the constant practice, the familiarity with the exam environment. You know, someone who's being very strategic before taking the exam, I probably thought about, well, I'm not going to spend more than 7 minutes on each question. Because, you know, something like that, you plan your way for the exam. You understand where to, like I said, find where to get these Kubernetes that are you. Trust me, the easiest step, the biggest, and the quickest way to get in this exam is registering, to get in the certification is registering for it.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So I'm going to go ahead and follow up. Can everyone see my screen? Can you see the slide?
Yes.
All right. So today, in the past, we've gone over some of these some of the resources in Kubernetes, and today we're planning on looking at etcd. And etcd is it's what maintains the Kubernetes state, the state of the Kubernetes cluster. So for the exam, etcd is part of your cluster administration. And today what I plan on doing is showing how to kind of like interact with the etcd running in our cluster. Something is really working against me today. So today, the environment I'll be doing this demo on, I have a 3-node cluster on AWS with a master and 2 working nodes. Let me go ahead and go to the environment.
Hi, guys.
All right. I think my demo is frozen. Let me close this. There we go. So I've SSH'd into my box, and just to make sure, just one more time, can everyone see my screen clearly?
Yes.
Great. Yes. So, get notes. So, like I said, I have one master running and two working nodes. And today we're working with etcd, right? So, kubectl get pods --, all namespaces. So, etcd. The entity for this environment I'm running is running in the kube system, and this is the etcd right here. This is the port that I'll be using for this, and it's running in the kube system, the etcd in the kube system namespace. So to jump into this, so let's run kubectl exec -it, and then the name of the port is, where are you? Let's see. All right, there you go. I have my glasses on, but I still can't see. CL system. Group system. Yeah. So right now what I'm doing is I'm creating a terminal inside of that, a bin shell inside of that etcd container. And so if I run ls, practically nothing in there. So what am I trying to do right now? First thing I'm trying to do right now is to list the members in this current etcd container, and how do I do that? So the first thing, there are two ways to actually interact with etcd here. You can either use the etcd command line to the just this one, or use the etcd command line to the version 3. For the exam, it's going to be, you would be required to use this particular etcd version. So you'd have to specify that you're using the API version 3, then type in etcd/ctl for the exam. Now, for people who just would like to understand how to use etcd to actually get all this done, I've decided on showing both ways of actually doing this. So the first one, etcd. So I'm trying to list the members on this etcd. So etcd. I have this written down somewhere. Dash endpoints. Now I need to pass in the CA set. No, I'm just going to copy this and paste it.
So Tunde, what exactly you want to do?
So right now what I'm trying to do is list the members. Wait, hold on.
Are you saying etcd members?
Yes.
Okay, so how many etcd servers are there?
I'm sorry?
So you're trying to figure out how many etcd members are there?
No, so right now what I'm trying to do right now is I'm just trying to show some of the commands that you can run using the etcd command line to write. Like, so for this exam, like some of the things that you can come across is like, you might be required to take a snapshot of the current etcd running in your environment. So right now there's only one running. So when I run this command, when I list the members, we should only see one.
Okay. So do you have to be in etcd server? I thought you could run this outside of it, like kubectl.
So for this one right now, I'm only doing this because I'm jumping into the shell. For the exam environment, you would have to jump into this container shell to do this.
So you do have to go into the pod of etcd?
Yes, yes. You would have to go into this to do this.
Okay, thanks.
So, Tunde, can you elaborate what exactly member means, member list?
So right now, what the members are actually doing is just telling you the number of etcd members that you're running, right? Right now, we only have one that is running.
Okay.
Let me change this command.
So these members run within the etcd container and there are multiple members?
No, it doesn't run within the, so right now there's only one. Let me just run this command and maybe I'll be able to show more like say more when I throw out the output of the command.
If I can answer that, basically etcd, you can have multiple copies, so that would be like multiple pods of etcd, right? So that's what he means by members. Like there could be four or five members of etcd all doing the same thing. It's like HA type of idea, right? Tunde, is that about right?
Thank you for that. All right, so there you go. So as you can see right now, it's only showing that we have one running. And it has the name in there. So one thing I was just trying to show is how to actually interact using the etcd CTL, right? So if you notice, I've passed in a couple of flags here, right? I'm using the endpoint flag. I'm passing in the CA set. I'm passing in the set file, and I'm passing the key. So some of you might be wondering, how did I know, like, what was going to go into each of these? And I'll show that very soon. So one other thing we might want to check here is the cluster health. So to check the cluster health, we can run the same command and with passing in this same, in this case, we're using the HTTPS keys and files. So if we check that, oh, cluster health. Where are you? I'm missing.
Oh, I think it's cluster health, one word with a dash.
Yes. So there you go. Right now it's telling us that this member that we just showed not too long, that is LD, and it was gotten from this address. So this is some of the things that you might come across, like maybe you might be told to actually check the cluster of the current etcd. This is one way to do that. Now, let me go ahead and, so for the exam environment, when I took the exam, the etcd were told to specifically, I can't remember if it was specifically to use that, but I wasn't able to use this default etcd command line tool. So what I did was I used this, the etcd CTL _API to set up to choose the version, and then passed in etcd CTL right after it. And now when you're using the version 3 of this command line tool, it's different. So now the keys, this CA file and the set file and key file that I've passed in here are quite different. Like these options do not exist when you're using this version, and I can show you that by typing the H. So as you can see, these are the options that are allowed in this case: the CA set, the set file, and the dash key. In the previous one, we had key file, and we had set file and CA set file. But you're still passing in the same keys, but just with different options. So in this case, for the CA certs that I'm highlighting in this case, it's going to take the HTTPS version, the key that was passed for the HTTPS, for verifying HTTPS enabled security. So let me show that. Some So as you can see, right now we're using the API version for 3, and this time around, we're passing in the endpoint still, but now we're using different options. We're using the CA set option, the set option, and the keys instead, but we're still passing in the same information, like we're passing in the key, the same key. We're passing in the same set here, and same thing goes for the other one. So let's check something else, maybe endpoint. So now this one doesn't have the option for cluster else like we checked earlier. So if you check endpoint else. And so as you can see, it says it, it's LD and successfully committed. So they're quite different. Let's see. So one thing I'm going to go ahead and show next now is, let me clear my screen, and I'm going to show how I'm doing.
I have a quick question. You know, if you run SCCDL member list by yourself, you can't, you have to pass the cert and all that kind of stuff?
Can you please run that question by me one more time?
If you run SCDCTL, right? You know, ETCDCTL, without the cert and keys and et cetera, can you just run that with member list? I thought you could.
No, it's not going to work in this case because of TLS.
Okay, so.
Yeah. So let me show that to you, etcd-ctl member list. As you can see, it says connection refused.
Okay, so you have to have a TLS and the keys and
It all has to do with the way it was set up.
Okay. Okay. So if it was not set up with TLS, then you can just run it.
Yeah. So initially, when this etcd was started up in the container, it probably had a and I was going to get to this, but since you already mentioned this, if I go out of this container shell and I run a kubectl describe. I'm going to show you how everything was started up, the command that is running inside of the container, and then you're going to be able to see that, well, it was started up with the sets and with this particular keys. So in order to interact with this, with the etcd on this particular URL, you have to pass these keys.
Okay. But in the test itself, is most of the time, is everything is set up with the keys and
access. Yeah. So in the exam, you're going to be provided this. You're going to be provided the key. If there's a question on like this on the exam, you're going to be provided the key. You're going to be provided the set, and you're going to be provided the CSS file in the exam. If you come across something like this, and they're going to tell you, you know, which is which, and all you just have to do is being familiar. You know, you've been able to take the etcd snapshots, you've been able to take the members. Trust me, like if you, by the time we complete this, for the cluster administration part of etcd for the exam, I believe you should be ready for that part.
Okay, thanks.
So right now, next thing I wanted to do was actually take a snapshot. So let's check for the snapshot option. Where are you?
Hey, Dudley, one question about etcd. I know it's a key value pair data store, but does it store the history of the state of your pods or your cluster, or it just has the current status, the etcd?
Does it store the history?
Let me repeat the question for everyone. Yes, so please. My question is, this etcd data store, does it store only the current state of the cluster, or does it also stores the history, like 1 day, 2 day, 1 month for the cluster?
I don't think it does. I don't think it has history. I don't know it well enough, but I don't think it does.
So the whole idea is to store the current state. So this current state, whenever you save, let's say you take a snapshot, maybe you have a job that is currently taking a snapshot of the etcd cluster. I think that should have, I think from your question, I'm thinking, you know, a way to actually refer to a previous point. So those snapshots are actually, I think they might be the history that you're referring to.
Yeah, I was wondering, you know, then what is the purpose? I mean, where do we use those snapshots? Yes. Do you have any use case?
So if you're looking at, the, can you see the, snapshots, this options right here?
Yeah, snapshot save, snapshot restore.
Restore and snapshot status.
Yeah.
So I was planning on showing the snapshot save first. So we're going to, what I'm trying to do right now is I'm going to save the current snapshot, create a save the snapshot and save that as a with a file name called snapshot DB or something else. Let's call it hello in this case.
Yeah.
And show a little bit more snapshots. Let's hello. Okay, so it's saved at hello. So if I type in ls, this is it right here. And so now if I run snapshot status, so it returns this file, and you're probably wondering what these are. So this is the hash, this is the file size, this is the revision, and let me show this in a more clear way. There you go. So this were those values you saw initially. So this is the hash, this is the revision, this is the total keys, and this is the total size. So for the exam, you know, if you're told to take a snapshot, this is all that is required. So they're going to probably ask you, you know, if it's a snapshot, they're going to probably ask you, you know, pass in a name, take a snapshot and name it something. So if it's hello world, you name it hello world. Sorry, I meant this command. So save it as this. So if it's hello world, you save it as this. If it's whatever you're being referred to, you save it as by that name. And so to check the status, this is how you do that. The most important thing in actually dealing with this, you know, interacting with this etcd right here is, you know, knowing how to pass in this, you know, the sets, you know, not being familiar with this command, knowing that this is how to take a snapshot. This is what I need. These are some of the informations I would need to pass in before, you know, doing any of this. Now, In a case whereby I wanted to restore, we probably all we need to do is pass in the restore here and pass in the name of the file. So let's say I created a different one. So snapshot save. So we created hello earlier, right? So I'm going to create another one called meetup. And see, we have meetup running. So I can do something like restore, let's see. Where are you? And there you go. And then I've been able to do a restore. So interacting with this is really, really easy. It's just taking you being familiar with this. You know, you're trying this out on maybe your Minikube or your environment. It's the same thing. Now, let me show you how to actually figure out where to get these keys. As you can see, these are the parts. So you can find out where these keys by just checking etcd Kubernetes. But the quickest way and the fastest way is to do this. Let me exit out of this. I'm going to exit out of this shell and run So, all right. I'm going to grab the name of the etcd container again. And what I'm going to do is, I'm going to run a kubectl describe. And the name, dash n, kubesystem. Okay. Am I missing anything? No. Right. So what I just did was run, I ran a kubectl describe, and if you look at a container right here, this is the command that was run inside of the container. And so the endpoint, what is happening? Sorry about that. So the endpoint, this is the endpoint right here. This were those set files that we saw earlier. This is the key file. And where is the CSS file? And the set file also. So I mean, this is one of the quickest way. Another way, so if you look at this also, now look at this exec, look at the liveness probe right here. See how they're using etcdctl to just check for the to do a liveness probe here. So this way I can easily tell that this was the CA set. This is the CA set to use. This is the set to use, and this is the key to use.
So in the exam, you can just take this command and run it, you know, the way you want to run, right? Like the members list or whatever, huh?
Right, right.
You can describe and take it. You don't have to remember it, or you don't have to search for that where the certificate is, etc.
No, you don't have to. One thing that you, one thing, like I said, one thing is familiarity, and you haven't done this yourself, so that when the exam, when you get to the exam environment, you know, you just, you're not, this doesn't catch you out of the blue, and you're like, you know, how do I take a snapshot? How do I view the members? How do I do any of this?
So basically, you can just do the liveliness part, like the guy was saying. You go in and you run the etcdctl API equal 3 and the rest of it, and not do the get foo, but just do like get member list or something.
Correct.
That's great. Thanks a lot. Thanks for showing this. This is fantastic.
Yeah, this is a good hint.
Yeah, so the whole idea of all this, of what we're doing, is actually show hacks or like quicker ways to actually get things done. In production environment, some of the ways that we're doing this, like in the past, like, you know, we showed ways to actually create manifests. So in production, you probably don't want to create the manifest interactively. What do I mean? Like maybe directly from the command line, whereby you cannot refer to it with any other thing. You want to create manifest in production, like declaratively, so that, you know, if there's something wrong, you can go back to something and recreate it. So that if you lose that container, there's always something to refer back to. So all that we're showing is quick ways, fastest ways to actually get this done, the easiest way. And, you know, this is tips and tricks on how to pass the CKA. So if anyone has any question on what I've just done with etcd, please feel free to ask now. Tunde, I'm going to pass the, for the next couple of things that we'll be doing, Tunde is going to be showing, doing the demo. But if there's any question on what I've just done now, please feel free to share with me, or you can ask me after Tunde's demo or during the in the chat.
Yeah, I do have a question.
Hi, Chief.
Okay. I wanted to know, like, for a beginner like myself who's just got into Kubernetes and all that, what path do you advise to take when it comes to studying for it? And also, I would also like some kind of mentorship and to know what it is about and everything, and how to, you know, sit for the exam, what materials to study, and how best to understand it. Because sometimes with things like this, you really have to know how to study for it, so that you don't waste the time studying reading so broad and things that are very unnecessary for you to know. And then so you can just, what are the main things that you should know, like the focus on everything?
Right. Let me just touch base on something. To answer your first question on, you know, some of the resources to go with. Now, to start learning Kubernetes, a couple of things are really going to help you. Being familiar with the Kubernetes.io documentation, that is going to take you a long places. Like, and also, Linux Academy has been known and to be a very, very good place to actually learn. I'll post the link in the chat, linuxacademy.com. They have great tutorial on, you know, getting started with CKA or getting ready for CKA.
I'm studying from there. They have a really good, like, 6 hours worth of video you can watch. And right now they're having a sale for like $300 for the whole year. And they got a bunch of other stuff too, like Jenkins. And yeah, I like Linux Academy.
Yeah. So besides the CKA, besides Linux Academy and Kubernetes.io, there are a great couple of GitHub repos that you can check out by just typing in the word Kubernetes. You'll see a lot of resources in there. And now to your final question about, you know, why are people taking the CKA? There's been a lot of demand for people who understand how to orchestrate containers. And you know, people need a way to actually show their skills to tell that, you know, I'm certified in this way, some kind of way to give credibility. And this is one of the things that the CKA provides to you. Now, for companies who are trying to actually become Kubernetes certified service providers, they require three certified Kubernetes administrators to become one of the requirements to become a certified Kubernetes provider is to have three CKAs. So all this is causing a demand in the, you know, in the job market for CKAs. And, you know, this is one step. So being a CKA is actually one step to actually getting your job. It also helps you to actually determine where you are at in your understanding with Kubernetes. Now, knowing, passing the CKA and what doing this, getting ready for CKA does not mean that you know everything in Kubernetes. I don't think anyone would ever know everything in Kubernetes. It just depends on how you're using it. So, but for one place to start from, you can start Linux Academy, the documentation. There've been a couple of other known platforms like Katacoda.com. It has a very, very friendly UI and environment terminal that you can use for practice on your own. And then most importantly, set up your own Minikube cluster, be it on your Mac or on your Windows, and just start playing with the kubectl command line. I'm going to right now, because it seems like I've really taken a lot of time. I'm going to go ahead.
Hello. I have a question, guys.
All right. This one, last one.
Okay, so I'm familiar with OpenShift, and I can see that there's a lot of similarities between OpenShift and Kubernetes. Yeah. So I'm just thinking, you know, do you guys have familiarity with it, and how does it convert? Because I'm looking at some of the commands that you're running for OpenShift. I've been using the OC command, which is basically, this describe, get pods, put, all those things seems to be very, very similar. So what do you guys think from someone that have experience with OpenShift, how does that type of experience, how does it transfer to something like Kubernetes? Even though I don't have direct hands-on experience with Kubernetes, I do feel like I'm somewhat familiar with it, because I understand some of the stuff that you guys are doing. So that's my question.
So the biggest difference between them is OpenShift is an enterprise version of Kubernetes that is being run by Red Hat. The differences are the command line tools. So Kubernetes uses kubectl, OpenShift uses OC as the command line tool. It has the same ideas also, right? You're orchestrating containers in OpenShift, you're orchestrating containers using Kubernetes. You know, you have pods in OpenShift, you have services. Some of the only things that might be different is how, you do RBAC. Some enterprise add-ons that you get with Red Hat, like maybe doing builds. And there is integration for that using Kubernetes also, but OpenShift is just making it quite easier. It's just the enterprise version. So, and there's some places you use OADM, and they have this concept called projects in OpenShift also.
Yeah.
You didn't see in Kubernetes. So those are just the differences. Let me go ahead and give Tunde the control right now, and so he can do the demo. And Benga, please, if you have any more questions, you and I, we can go at it in the chat, please.
Yeah. All right, thanks, Chief.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Hello. All right. So. Okay. All right. So for my part, I'm going to be talking about just two things. I mean, what he talked about is going to be a major point. Trust me, that particular question could be it's the easiest question that you can meet. And if you're not prepared for it, it could be the hardest question. You'll be like, what? What am I doing? All right. And one thing also, he talked about all the parts. But before I go forward, I would like to show you guys something. I love the quickest way to like everything. Just boom, let's get it done. So one thing I would like to show you guys is why am I on YouTube? All right. All right, so I would like to show you guys, if you do your exam, right, you have access to kubernetes.io. Some of you may be wondering, like, how do I memorize all those commands that he mentioned, right? So there's a trick. Just all you have to do is just Google for, etcd, as you can see, I already did that before, etcd version 3. Why do I always? Okay.
You can move your screen a little bit to the left.
All right. So what? Google, just search for this, etcd API version 3, and it should take you to where you actually take the snapshot, etcd. Snapshot. All right. So you may need this during the exam. This is the page, right? So how to backup an etcd cluster. This is the command. If you don't want to memorize, this is the command. But as you can see, a couple of things are missing. The SAT option, right? So those are missing. Just all you have to do is just type in etcd, type in this and put that H. That will show you up the option like he showed us during the presentation, and you can pass in those options. But if you don't remember all the command, just search for etcd API version, API 3, and that will take you to this page, and you can copy this command, and that should guide you on what your next step is going to be. But that's regarding that. So for this presentation, I'm going to be showing one particular part that is very important, because whether you are taking CK or you are taking CKAD, I can promise you something, you will deal with volumes, right? They will tell you to mount volumes, to create volumes, to delete volumes. And that's about, I saw a question that was about 8 points on volume, And 8 points is a very big point. So, all right. So in my example, I'll be running this on an EKS cluster. So I'm interacting with EKS. EKS is a managed Kubernetes. For those who are not familiar, so I'm going to be doing my example on EKS, right? I have my manifest already. So to make things very easy. Now, let's say you are in an exam and they tell you, please create a volume of this particular class manual with this particular size, 0.5 gigabytes. How do you do that? From I know most of us can do this. If they give us 30 minutes, if they give us 1 hour, we can do this, right? How do you do that? How do you do that in during the exam? I mean, what I do is, trust me, I'm really, really lazy. Just PV. I just search for PV, right? And create a port with PV, past 10 volume for storage. Boom, you have a PV, right? That you, what you do is you change the class because they will give you a different class. Let's say the class that they told you that the volume must be of is called class XYZ. So you change the name of the class to XYZ. They will tell you the storage must be 3 gigabytes. Change the storage to 3 gigabytes. Then you copy this, right? Put it in a file, kubectl apply, right? So they told us create a persistent volume with a size of 0.5 gigabytes, right? And the storage class is manual. And the access mode must be read, write, many. I have that in my manifest. What I do is I simply copy this, right? I copy this, paste it right here. They want me to name the PV persistent volume. That should be the name. They want the storage class to be manual. They want the capacity to be 0.5 gigabytes. They want the access mode to be read, write, many. And they want, you know, me to use the host path. Okay, easy. Once you have this, all you have to do is just go to kubectl, apply, file. Okay, all right. Boom. And the volume should be created, yes. So kubectl, describe, volume, stem volume, that's the name of the log, PV volume. All right. And that our volume has been created. The as you can see, the capacity is about 0.5 gigabytes. And the storage class is the storage class is the same name as what we were told. And everything looks right. Boom, we move on to the next question. Now the next question is create a PVC. For those of us who are not familiar with Kubernetes, a persistent volume is just like you creating a storage. It's like you creating your own disk. That's a persistent volume. Hey, I want a disk with 0.5 gigabyte in size. That is what a persistent volume is. Now, what is a PVC? A persistent volume claim. That is you making a request like, hey, can you give me 0.3 gigabytes out of that volume? That is what you are doing. So what Kubernetes does is it goes out into the cluster and look for a persistent volume or a storage that matches your class, the class that you specified, and can satisfy that requested size. In this case, I'm requesting for 0.3 gigabytes. And in the cluster already, we have a PV that has 0.5 gigabytes with the same class as this. So it simply goes in there and gives you what you need. So it's like you're making a claim that A is 0.3 of this is 0.5 PV is mine and mine alone, right? All right, so you may be asked
but in the claim you are mentioning,
all you have to do is just,
name of the person,
you like me,
right?
Go to the search box, this is your best friend, boom, PVC. Okay, it's probably going to be on the same page. Sometimes you get unlucky and you land on the wrong page. Boom, boom, persistent volume. I'm very sure somewhere down there there's a PVC. Yes, copy this, change the name to whatever they want you to change it to, the access mode. Make sure you are very careful about the requested storage. They will tell you the size that they want. Bam, sorry, specify it, keeps it till applied. In this case, I've already made mine. All I have to do is just keep CTR, apply. All right, tap. All right, so that creates my PV clean. Okay, keep CTR describe PVC log PV clean. Now, these are separate questions. It's been created. All right. Okay, PVC, blah, blah, blah. Everything that we have is, this is the request. This is what you request, but you have a capacity to expand to 0.5 gigabytes for those that caught this, Does anyone have any questions so far? I know I'm rushing through this. I'm trying to like be done.
Tunde, can you hear me?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay. So I was asking, in the persistence volume claim file, you need to mention the name of the persistence volume or no?
Oh, you don't have to. Kubernetes does that for you. So Kubernetes does the matching, right? As you can see, I'm not specifying the name of the PV, right? I'm telling Kubernetes, hey, just find me a guy that meets this requirement. I don't care, you know, who created the guy, what the guy was created for. Just find me a guy that has this particular storage class and can give me this.
So what if you have multiple PVs, though? Do you have to, if you have multiple PV, do you have to specify which PV you want?
So if you have, if you have multiple PV, right, this storage class is what differentiates different PV. This storage class, as you can see, you have to specify the storage class. That tells you the kind of PV that you're looking for. In my production, let me give an example. In my production environment, we use EFS. For those that are familiar with AWS environment, EFS is Elastic File System. That's like an NFS, right? So when we create our deployment, I simply tell it, hey, I want a PVC that is of type EFS. It must be of storage class EFS. It must be an EFS PV that is of, 1 gigabyte. I want you to give me. So that storage class has to match.
Yeah, I think he was asking that, what if we have multiple persistent volumes of type manual? We can have that situation, right?
Yeah, we can have it.
So Kubernetes is going to decide by itself that which one it's going to allocate for us?
I think it's probably better to just claim a specific one. Say, I want this particular...
You want this particular PV, right? Is that what you're saying? That, hey, I want this particular PV with this particular name.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
So if you have multiple PV and you're trying to view the details...
Sure, you can do that. You have the option of doing that. In fact, you have the option of, in Kubernetes, you have the option of say, hey, even if I don't specify, I don't specify like a storage class. This is the storage class I'm talking about. We call it default storage class. So in that case, you're in a situation whereby, hey, I want this particular PV because this PV is very, very special to me. I don't want anything else. You can also do that. Right.
Okay.
I think I did that in a situation whereby, so we use LDAP, right? Right. So we have a job that backs up LDAP to S3, right? So now there's a way that we did it in such a way that there's a particular PV that the LDAP gets backed onto, and another job comes in and take those files and put them in S3, right? So in that case, we use a specific PV. You don't just go out and pick any PV that you want. It has to be that particular PV.
Okay.
So it's possible also to do that. Sorry, I misunderstood your question. Sorry about that. All right.
Now, if you're done with this, Tunde, can you also explain that how to assign or allocate this persistent volume claim to a specific pod?
Oh, yes. So
we define that in the pod, huh? Okay, you're going there.
Oh, I'm going to show that.
Okay.
All right. All right, in this case, so one of the questions that you will get is the fact that they want you to do some magic with those volume that you created. Hey, you told me you know how to create a PVC. The PVC has been created. Can you do something very simple to me? For me, rather. We call it a sidecar issue. What is a sidecar? So most deployments always have one container, most deployments, but it's possible to have multiple containers in a pod, as you can see in this case. Now, we have certain container whereby they are like secondary container. They do some job for the main container. That's what, when you hear people talk about sidecar, for example, a container that does some, I don't know, backup or it could be anything that you want, right? So in this case, the main container is the reader container. Oh, well, depending on who you're talking to. Let's say in this case, the main container is the reader container. The job is to read a particular file. The sidecar container is the writer container. The job is to write into that file, right? So you will most likely encounter something in this situation. But the question is, mount the PVC that you created, mount it on this pod, mount it on each container in this pod. So mount it in the reader, mount it in the writer. Now, make sure that write, you know, a command whereby the writer writes into a particular file in the directory of the mount. And the reader reads from that particular file and reads it and outputs it. The last thing is going to be save the output of the reader in a directory on your local host. Let me repeat myself. Mount this PVC, mount it in each container. Make sure that the writer writes to a particular directory. It will give you the directory. Read from that particular directory and output it into the, just output into the console. Now, this is what you do. In this case, the writer, all it's doing is just writing current date to this file. I took this PVC, I mounted it into this container, I mounted it to this location. Now, I'm telling this particular writer container to be writing into lol.yaml. Just keep writing the date every 3 seconds. Write the date, go to sleep for 3 seconds, come back, write the date, go to sleep for 3 seconds. Now, I want this guy to tell that particular log file and output it. That's what you simply do. This is a question about, I'm not really sure, something like this is going to be about, it's a lot of points, but it's a very like in the long question. So they will assign points to question like this. So, sorry, I should have removed this earlier, but I still need to do that. All right. So let's go ahead and do this. And let's run the pod. Enough. Keeps it here. Apply. Okay. One C sidecar. Okay. Damn. Okay. The pod has been created. Keeps it here. Vlogs. Remember, they told you to create that and save the output of the reader into a particular file on your local system, right? So now let's go and see the reader. This log app is the name of our pod. The container, if you try to do this, it will tell you, hey, you have two container, what are you doing? So the container that we are trying to look at, let's look at the writer. This is probably not doing anything. It's not giving you any output. Now let's look at the reader itself. The reader. All right, the reader is outputting those things that were written to the file, outputting them. Now what they want you to do is save the output, save this particular output and save it to a particular location, temp dot. They will give you like a bunch of string, like very, very string number, X, Y, whatever. So log, but if you're like me during the exam, after saving those outputs, I made sure I did something. I actually went into the file itself to confirm those outputs were actually inside the file. You can do this, or you can just copy the output and save it inside the file. So does anyone have any questions?
Yeah, what's the switch you put in there? F dash log F dash C, what is it doing?
Oh, it's looking, so this guy is looking at that pod, right? And it's saying, but inside this pod, we have two containers. So if you try to do it without the C, it will tell you, hey, I have two containers inside of me. Which one do you want? Okay. Tell me. So you tell it that, hey, I want the logs from the reader.
Okay.
Yeah. So this.
Now Tunde, the same thing you can tell in that log file, the YAML file, right? Where the writer is writing. You can tell that also because that should be on your local machine. Hey, I cannot hear you. Can you hear me? Tunde, we cannot hear you.
Yeah, you're muted, Tunde.
Now you're good. No, we cannot hear it, Tunde.
Yeah, I can't hear anything either.
What about now?
Yep, now it's good.
Much better.
Oh, sorry about that. My,
Did you understand my question?
Yeah, you said we should look at the writer container to look at the log, right?
No, I was saying that can we tail that YAML file on the local machine? Like I think it's a var log directory on your local machine. That's where we created that mount point or that file in your container.
Oh yes, so
writer container.
If you know the node, right? Since you know the location where the volume was created, you can do that.
Okay.
Right? You can actually go in, but trust me, it's not worth your time during the exam.
Oh and, really?
Yeah, it's totally not worth your time. When you can actually get the results in an easier way by just tailing the logs of the reader container. One other alternative that you can do is since the pod itself, since one of the container is writing to a certain location. Remember, this guy, the writer itself is writing to this location. You can also go inside this particular container and get the log. So if you want to get the log from the writer, you can actually go kubectl exec log app. Log app container. I want to look at the writer. All right. Gimme. So we know that these volumes was mounted to this point. Okay, that's one. All right. So ls. Right. So you can actually tell this log itself to get what you want on the writer because they are both mounted. This file is mounted on both container. So both container have access to it.
Yep.
Yeah. So yeah, so just practice this. It's going to be a bunch of requirements. Make sure you don't mix up the name. Make sure you don't mix up the specified volume size. Don't worry about the storage class because they will give you a very weird storage class name. Don't worry about that. They already have that figured out. Just put in the storage class that you were told and the world is going to be a better place, right? So Now let's do the last thing. The last thing is going to be the probing. For those that are familiar with Kubernetes, they know what is wrong here. Right. So they will give you a deployment, something about, hey, there's a deployment that is failing. What is wrong? Figure it out. It's crashing. Nothing is coming up. It's trying to come up, but it keeps dying. Right. So keep CTL. Let me do this so that I just show everybody. All right. Excuse me. Keep CTL. Get port. All right. I mean, right now everything looks all right. This is our newly created port. It looks like, hey, everything looks all right. Nothing is wrong here. Except, you know, after a while you start watching the you will notice crashing. The port will start crashing. Keep CTL, describe port. All right. As you can see, now they will tell you something is wrong about this port. It's not coming up. It's supposed to be serving traffic, but it's not coming up. The best way to figure out what is wrong with the particular port is to describe the port. I mean, when I say describe the port, look at the event coming out from the port. Most of the time, the port is going to tell you what, I don't know, should I use he or she? I mean, what it's doing. So the port is going to tell you, hey, this is what I'm doing. And that information is going to be in the events page, right? So you can also say kubectl get event. But the best way that we also tell you what is going on in the cluster, the ports that are dying, what is happening in the cluster. So the best, if you have that kind of question, is this is failing, figure out why. Look at the event, get event. Event is going to tell you what is going on. And once you know which deployment is failing or which port is failing, go and look at the port itself. Go and look at the port event. It's saying the liveness probe of the port is failing. Now look at the port specification. Kubectl. Okay, this is the port. Kubectl. Because in the exam itself, you will not have access to the manifest. Look at this, look at the port YAML file. This is the YAML file of the port, right? It tells you most things about the port. So if you look at the probe, go there. If you look at the probe, where is the probe? I'm totally blind here. All right. Okay, can someone tell me where the probe is? Okay, oh yeah, right here. So this is the probe, right? This is an Nginx port. It's supposed to be listening on port 80. But if you notice, the probe itself is listening on port 8040. They will tell you to fix it. So all you have to do is just edit the deployment. So keep it here. Get deployment, right? This is the name of the deployment, kubectl edit deploy, web deployments. All right, so all you need to do is just go and fix the probe. All right, fix it to 80 and everybody should be happy. All right, that gets applied immediately, kubectl get port. All right, we should have new deployments coming up, yes. And if you look at the event logs, if you look at the event in that particular pod, damn it, not logs, damn it. Kubectl, describe, pod. All right, so the pod is running and we don't have any other issue in the cluster. So these two questions, trust me, the first one about PV, I can bet you that one is coming out. Because I saw it in my CK and I saw it in my CKAD at the end of the question, at the end of the, I think about towards the end. So no porn, know how to create PVC, and you should be good.
So that edit, a quick question, the edit command that you did to, even though YAML, I haven't used that. So basically you just do output YAML, look at it, and if you do edit on any kind of deployment, even though there's no YAML, if you edit it, it will apply it.
Exactly, we do the apply for you.
Okay.
Right. But I don't think you are doing in the YAML. You are doing directly on the deployment.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying the output was YAML to look at it. Then.
Yeah. So to make a permanent change, you need to go and change the YAML file as well for future changes.
Right.
Otherwise, yeah.
Right. But in that situation.
Here. That's here. Right here.
YAML file.
All right. Does anyone have any question? I knew I rushed through that because I'm trying to like keep to time. All right.
Yeah, that was good. Thanks. Appreciate it.
No problem. It's a pleasure. Always a pleasure. All right. So, I mean, based on what we've talked about so far in this series, trust me, what we've talked about so far, if you can focus on those, you have at least 85% of the question. Make sure you know how to take a snapshot. That could make a difference between you getting a 70 and 74. Right. I failed my 4CK, so don't feel bad.
Okay.
Make sure you know how to do that. And the volumes also, make sure you know how to do that. Volume is going to count about maybe 25%, no, maybe like 20% of the question of volume related. You're going to get about a lot of volumes related question. Mount this volume, create empty volume, create host path volume, those kind of questions. Make sure you focus on that and you shouldn't have much of a problem.
Okay. All right.
Hey, Tunde, did you guys already covered the questions related to config maps and secrets in the past meetups, or you're going to cover in future?
Oh yeah, I would like, you know, the other team to keep on that.
Hey, Sanjay.
Let me stop sharing.
Can everyone hear me?
Yep, we can hear you.
Hey, great. Yeah, yes, a real Tunde again. Well, in the past, yes, we've talked about config maps, and we've talked about secrets, I believe. Yeah. We've talked about config maps, secrets, and we've showed ways to actually inject config maps into ports that are running imperatively, and also using the manifest. So we've done that, those two different ways. So you can refer back to like the first series, second series, if you think that is something we've missed. You can find some of those there. And I just shared some links on the chat also, in the chat. So some of the things we didn't touch base on in this meetup was, in this current series, is we didn't talk about some of the things that happened in the first series. We don't want this to be repetitive, and because we only have 1 hour, 30 minutes, and we would like for people to be able to ask questions. So I and Tunde put this into perspective earlier, and we decided on writing blogs on some of these things. So if you check out the links that I've shared in the chat, you can find blogs on how to create pods and some other Kubernetes resources. And also I wrote a blog on my experience taking the CKA and also the CKAD. And there is also a link in there also for people who are trying to find solutions to some of the things they're working on in DevOps in general. So feel free to check those out.
Okay, so the links, are you gonna post them on Meetup also or just here?
Yeah, I'll definitely post them on the Slack channel. And also, now that you've asked, I'll post it on the Meetup page also. But please, feel free to join on the Slack channel. You can contact I and Tunde
okay
as possible, and every other person in the in the community through the Slack channel. Trust me, there are a lot of people with a lot of knowledge about Kubernetes in that Slack channel.
Okay.
A lot of opportunities also for those who are looking for jobs as DevOps engineers. And for those who are actually looking to hire DevOps engineers, feel free to post also in that channel, in the Slack channel. There is a Slack channel called Jobs. And the link, I think Tunde posted the link already. Join and feel free to, if you're looking for a job as a DevOps engineer, feel free to post on the Jobs page.
Great, thanks a lot.
Anybody have any other questions for Tunde and the other Tunde?
Nope, you guys are great.
Yeah, appreciate it. Appreciate it.
Yeah, this is good.
Thank you. Thank you. And also, if you'd like to see any other topics in the consequent meetups, we have a couple of meetups that are scheduled that we're yet to announce. And some of them have been announced already. And also, if you're in Colorado, expect to see I and Tunde soon. We'll be showing on site. We're actually hosting a meetup on site in Colorado. There will also be one, hopefully in October, by the end of October or late October, in Dallas, Texas also. So expect to meet us on site here in Dallas also.
So are you guys in Colorado? Are you guys in Denver or where are you?
Right now, I am located in Dallas, Texas.
Okay. I'm in Denver.
Hey.
All right. Hey. Denver, the Broncos.
Hey, we have a very huge community with different people from different places. Hey, like, this is why I like to, like, whenever we start a meetup, I like to have, like, people talk and just, you know, kind of share about, you know, why they're here and where they're from and all that.
Okay.
Hey, it's good to have you all here. I and Tunde, we're still open to questions. And after this meetup, till we run out of time and you remember that you have a question, feel free to reach out to I and Tunde on the Slack channel, maybe at Tunde or at Yair on the, just if you want to piss everybody off on the Slack channel, you can send a broadcast message on the Slack channel or just reach out privately to Tunde or
All right, we'll do. Thank you. I gotta go, guys. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. I will see you guys next week.
All right,
have a good day.
Thanks, Tunde and Tunde.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
All
right,
thanks.
Appreciate it.
Yep, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.